present this full day. We're here in the morning. We'll be over in Pecos this afternoon, a full day of information sessions about the transformation initiative and focus on guided pathways. So to kick this off, we have a video that has been provided us by the district office and a couple of quick slides introducing the concept that this is a new concept to you. So let's watch the video.
These are really exciting times for the Maricopa Community Colleges. We've been serving the community for many years. We are one of the key players in how the economy of the state thrives or doesn't thrive. And we need to be very mindful of how we educate students that can access those jobs.
We all have a stake in this, and we're all going to make a difference.
And this matters, and what we do in these next few years matters.
Because we need to adapt to the changes in the community.
And really put that student back in the center so that they can be successful, which is what we all want, which is why we're all here, what we're all passionate about, and that's why this is great.
There are three areas in the transformation. One area is student support and guided pathways. We are developing new industry partnerships, and then we are looking at ways of making our enterprise, our institution, more effective and efficient.
Many students come to us not being sure what they plan to major in. Guided pathways and student support gives them the pathway to follow and the people to help them stay on that pathway.
Industry partnerships are critical to the work that we do in community colleges. Building connections, building internships is crucial to their success.
Through enterprise performance, we're not only going to have more engaged employees, but we're really going to look at our system to ensure all colleges are working together and aligned in tandem.
We don't want to become an antiquated system that can't serve the students, and this lets us have a chance to change that so that they can face tomorrow. They're empowered, they're ready, they have jobs.
The thing about the transformation is that we're leaving nothing to chance, that we're bringing all of our good work, all of our resources to ensure that no students fall off.
It is critically important that we are that solution, that we develop the programs and the pathways that get the students on that way to getting the jobs that are important to the state of Arizona.
It's a great time to be in Maricopa to impact student success.
The dedication, the hard work, the innovation that already exists and the faculty and staff around the district is going to allow Maricopa to be very successful with this transformation.
We're doing it for the students. We're doing it to serve the community. And at the end of the day, we're doing it because we want to have a state that is thriving economically with very engaged and educated citizens.
So by means of introduction, as you saw in the video, this is a change that's taking over the culture and the way we do business throughout Maricopa. Today our emphasis is going to be on one part of that, which has to do with guided pathways. But this is the overall vision of the transformation activity that's going on across the whole district. And if we wrap with some of the, we could. Next. Slide. So, as you again heard in the video, this is an emphasis on responding as a system to the workforce and the educational needs across the whole county. We're not only talking about student success, but acting more like a system of colleges. And our next slide and last slide in this part is really just an emphasis on the importance of all of us across the entire aspect of our institution, whether you are a staff member, working in student support services, working generally in administrative services to support, or certainly teaching or supporting our academic programs, you're going to be involved in this. And it's going to take everybody's expertise and everybody's efforts. So we wanted to use this to kind of kick off the activity that will focus on the guided pathways portion of the whole transformation experience. And to do that, I'm going to introduce our consultant, Rob Johnston.
All right, thank you very much. It's good to chat with you guys today. I'm going to switch over here to a different presentation. And we're mainly going to talk today. This is going to be, I've done a number of presentations in the district kind of on opening, what I think was opening day or opening week. And my organization, NCI, I'm the founder and president of the National Center of Inquiry and Improvement. I've been working around the country for the last decade doing work. I'm a former dean and provost from the California Community College System in the Bay Area at Foothill College. I was the lead board rep at Foothill when Maria was the lead board rep here 10 years ago, so I know her pretty well. So I've seen this from the ground, and I've also been working around the country on projects the last 6-7 years of guided pathways. And so we'll talk a little bit about an intro to guided pathways, and then I'll let you ask a lot of questions, see examples, see where your place is in this. I think the one thing that's important to emphasize here is that look, I know that there's been some conversation within Maricopa. You've had a couple colleges doing some work, and the rest of us kind of wondering what's going on with guided pathways. I think what we're trying to do, what the district is trying to do, is get everyone on the same page, working together. And I would say that it's really important to recognize that the work here is actually ahead of you. There haven't been a bunch of decisions made in the back office where things are already done and we're going to roll it out and hand it to you. That's not how this works. I'm going to talk about the big ideas of guided pathways. You'll see this is going to take, this is not something that you can do, as you saw on the first slide there. It's not an initiative. This is something, it's a movement towards something you're becoming. But before we get started, there's so few of us, I think we can actually just do this. Can you give me your name and what area of the college you're from so I kind of know where folks are based in the college and maybe can tailor some of the questions and content to that?
So go ahead and start here. Andrew
Grimes,
I'm the executive secretary to the
dean. Cool. I'm Melissa Roybal. I'm the interim coordinator
of enrollment services. Great. Kimberly Lee, I'm here at Williams University and Social Services.
Cool. Great. Thank you.
Mo Hernandez, I'm out here at Williams campus and I do that here.
Cool. Awesome. Okay, great, thank you.
Monica Johnson, Faculty Library at Williams Campus.
Library? Cool, thank you.
Joan Krzyzewski, I work here at Williams in Financial Aid.
Awesome.
Maria, but I work here at the Williams Campus in Academic.
Cool, and then this table? Your peers may not know you, you never know.
Beth Nettadola, this is faculty at the Pegasus Campus.
Chris Schmick, Dean of Arts and Sciences. Hi, everybody.
Bill Guerrero.
Cool. All right. Thank you. That just makes it a little easier. The 9 a.m. time does not have a lot of faculty in it usually, so you two, Beth, and you guys have to represent here. But faculty questions. One of the things about this, I just want to share a little bit about this. It sometimes seems like guided pathways just dropped out of the sky. Like, we were just doing our work, and all of a sudden there was guided pathways. We were being told to do it. I can see the faces. I can see the faces. You guys can't. Yeah, that's a very common response. I just want to just briefly take the arc of the story a little bit of how we get to here nationally and why we think it's so important. You go back 10 years to like 2008, no one's talking about guided pathways. We've used the term pathways a lot before. We've had career pathways, we've had K-12 to community college pathways. But this term guided pathways rose out of some research. And our friends at the Community College Research Center at Columbia, which is, I'm just going to sit this, I can't sit down because somebody needs to see me. Community College Research at Columbia did a lot of research on what's going on in the community college system. These folks, men and women, are very dedicated to helping community colleges, not doing research about them and saying why they're not working. But back in the mid-2000s, a woman named Judith Scott Clayton wrote a paper called The Shapeless River. And she'd done a lot of research on community college students and how they struggle and why they struggle. She came up with this kind of mental picture of how many our community college students move through the institution. She says it's like being on a river at night, winding its way through a jungle with no lights on your boat and no moon. And this is just kind of a powerful imagery around you're almost guaranteed to run aground, and when you do, it's really hard to get back on path, right? And so there are many of our students are lost, they're confused. They're not sure where they're going. And before we get, you know, sometimes we occasionally get preachy and condescending about they should know where they're going. I'll tell you some stories later that may make this pretty poignant about, we wouldn't know where we were going either if we were them. So we have this assumption that they should be able to figure it out. And so she wrote this paper in about 2008, and then Davis Jenkins, who I usually call the grandfather of Guided Pathways when he's in this room, because he's like 10 years older than me, so I like calling him grandfather of Guided Pathways. In about 2010, wrote a paper called Get With a Program. And this was an interesting set of research. What it basically said was, if you look at students who concentrate in their first year, one of the problems we have is we don't know who's in a program at a lot of our colleges. Like, people are just taking courses. We don't know what they're doing. They're just kind of randomly taking courses. So we had to come up with a proxy for getting into a program because we didn't really have programs. And so what we used was someone taking 9 or more units from the same kind of focus area. We used zip codes to do that. So they're taking 9 or more units from one area, right? Now that could be psychology, it could be surge tech, could be aviation, but they have some focus in their first year. And if you look at students who do that in the first year, have 9 units in a focus area versus those who don't, and then compare their graduation rates, it's pretty interesting. This data is really consistent across states and colleges, but the most recent data came out of Tennessee that I saw. And if you did that in your first year, had a 46, 47, 48% graduation rate. If you didn't do that in your first year, it was down around 15%. So this idea of what we ended up calling momentum, right? The idea that you're concentrating in an area and making momentum towards something, and that's a 30-point difference. Think about that for a second. That's, if you don't concentrate in your first year, only 1 in 7 students are actually ever completing. We'll come back to the full-time, part-time thing a little bit later. But so this started looking at this notion of program completion, and then the Gates Foundation funded a project called Completion by Design, the first national Guided Pathways project, and CCRC, and my organization, and a couple others, worked on it with what ended up being 9 colleges in 3 states. There were 5 in North Carolina, there were 3 in Ohio, and Miami-Dade in Florida. Texas was involved in the year 1, but went off to do their own thing. And these 9 colleges, this was the Wild West, right? We didn't have any thought capital. We had these ideas. We had colleges who signed on. There was, by the way, a $60 million project from the Gates Foundation. Colleges probably got on average, you know, there's money going to various organizations as well as evaluation, but they got a couple $1 million each to do this. And it's not ongoing money, right? So you can't hire faculty with it, you can't hire student services with it. But it was seed money to help this kind of get going. And this was, the national partners, along with Jobs for the Future and the Public Agenda, were trying to help these colleges. They were trying to figure out, it was hard in the early days. And then the next big event that happens is in 2013, the American Association of Community Colleges, who is our trade association in DC, right? They do much more than that, they do leadership development. They're fighting for community colleges in Washington, trying to get us more funding, more respect. They come out with a report called the 21st Century Learning Commission, which basically says, I'm paraphrasing slightly, community colleges have been doing a great job with limited resources and a broken system. But we have to fundamentally change the way students enter and move through our institutions so that more of them can complete. I mean, that's a pretty landmark event when our own organization said, you know what, we've been working, let's be clear, it's not that people weren't being good people in the system, but they're saying we weren't doing the right things. The system is the problem, not the people. So we need to work on these systemic changes. So that happened in 2013. Then in 2015, there was another national project, the AACC Pathways 1.0 project, where we opened the doors. This time we had another Gates-funded project. It was about $10 million, maybe $8 million. No money went to the colleges. Not only did no money go to the colleges, they had to sign on to come to 6 institutes over a 2.5-year period, spread out all over the country. Travel costs probably about $75,000. And they had to send a team of 5 to 7 people, including their president, going to all 6 2.5-day institutes. Homework before the institutes, assignments after the institutes to fully implement Guided Pathways at scale by fall of 18, this coming fall. So 3-year, which is a really aggressive timeline. And when we had spots for 30 colleges to do this, and we had no idea when we put out the application if anyone would come. And what happened was somewhere near 200 colleges immediately expressed interest in doing this. And so the reason I say all this is because this is not something that just dropped out of the sky. Now Maricopa, obviously, you guys are unique, and sending 10 colleges, to 10 teams, to go to a national thing would cost you guys $750,000. I mean, it would be a really, or $1.5 million if you worked, we've worked this out at one point. And so when we were talking with leadership last fall about building something that we could come to you, so my organization, NCII, started something last year called H-U-I-2, it's Agency Attitude Intensive Implementation. So I now spend most of my time working directly with colleges. And there's, you guys are a special case, but there's 13 other colleges who I'm working with where we go six times for the college over a two-year period, so we bring it to you. And so we were talking with Maria, and we came up with for Maricopa, because you guys are so unique, it's a hybrid model. We're actually gonna do the six institutes, we just did the first one last month, we got five more coming, and we're coming to the colleges. So I'm here 4 days in a row, I'm doing the top four of the alphabet. My colleagues, Gretchen Schmidt and Kay McClenny, are getting here today, and they're doing the other six colleges. So we're seeing all 10 colleges in 4 days. We're gonna do that four times. And the idea is, look, the work is yours. This is not our work. There's no binder I'm gonna hand you and say, here, guess what? You're on week three, you're doing item 7B. It's not like that. We're gonna talk about some big ideas. Maricopa has made some decisions about design principles that will go between the colleges, but that's just kind of the set. Anyone have questions about the setup for this? And the reason why, by the way, that we're doing this is even though Maricopa is better than most community colleges, many community colleges, you still have a completion plus transfer rate that is around 40%, right? Right around 40%, which means that 6 out of 10 students who start here don't finish. That's actually why you're doing this, not because it's a project or someone signed on or a consultant in Hawaiian shirt or someone wrote a book. You're doing this because it's not okay that 6 out of 10 students who come here don't reach their goals. And by the way, they are disproportionately low income, which means they are disproportionately students of color. Nowhere is the equity mission sharper in this country, I would say, than here, in the greater Phoenix area, where some of the tensions, you guys, I don't have to tell you about the tensions that go on here, but I think the equity mission is even stronger in Phoenix than it is most places. This is about social justice, it's about equity, it's about a sense of urgency that we can't let things go on the way we always have. We know exactly what will happen if we don't change things, right? But, you know, the definition of insanity is to do the same thing over and over and expect something to change. Like, we've been doing the same thing for 50/500 years, right, with this system. So the trick to this is how do we work on the systemic things to help more students get through and complete. But it's really important to remember we're doing this not because there's a bunch of national initiatives and you guys signed on to do something. You're doing it because you believe you can get 6 out of 10 or 7 out of 10 students who start Maricopa to complete. It's a big goal. Right? And if you move that goal, then you would disproportionately be moving it with low-income students and students of color. We've always said are the ones we want to make sure we're serving. And the data suggests that we're not. Right? We have gaps both on income level, we have gaps on equity as well. Stop. Any questions about the setup here before we get into it? Observations? Concerns? Not enough coffee? So I'm not going to move on until someone at least observes something. That's how I do this. Uncomfortable silence. Anything about the getting to here? I'm good with uncomfortable silence. You guys really want me to keep going? Let's get there.
So at our college, where do we have the more successful completion trajectories?
Yeah.
What programs would have the most successful, the more successful transfer?
I have a question. When you talk about completion or transfer, I mean, we have a lot of occupational programs that finish, get a certificate, and they're out the door. They're not transferred.
We usually talk about one-year certificates or longer being all counting as completion. But if someone's here, so here's the reason we do that. Short-term certificates are a really interesting discussion point for this conversation. And I would say it highly varies on the market value of those short-term certificates, both short-term and long-term. So there are some things we do in the short-term that have high impact in the labor market, right? When I do my normal stump speech, I talk a lot about how all of our students are career-focused, from getting a two-course certificate to getting a PhD. I mean, I went 9 straight years, I was 100% Pell all 9 years. I really needed a career at the end of that to start paying off everything that I've been borrowing for 9 years, right? So whether it's one course or 9 years, they're all career focused. But I think the trick to the short-term certifications is, are we getting people into a job that has a pathway at the end of it, where it's not just the first job they're getting, but there's a second, third, and fourth job that usually requires more education. So I think it depends on exactly the focus of some of those short-term certificates? Did you have any in mind when you brought it up?
Well, yeah, when I think of a short-term certificate, I think of a program that's working towards a licensure, towards something that someone would get something from the state or from the
certification program, almost.
Or
yeah.
Certification,
yeah.
Because that is a long-term type.
Yeah, so, right. And so let me throw some numbers out there. Because we do, I want to make really clear, we in California term some version of what you're talking about as skills building. So you have people who are out in industry already who come back to get certifications to help them get either keep their job or get the next job. And that is absolutely a mission of community colleges. When you look at the numbers, though, of when students come to community colleges and what percentage of them say they want to get a bachelor's degree eventually, even if they start there, it's around 85%. Someone told me it's higher in Maricopa. It's closer to 90%. But nationally, just someone who hasn't been at community college before, they could have been anywhere, they could be 18 from high school, they would be 48 coming from another job, 85% of them say they want to get a bachelor's. So, this issue about certification, I think the question is that there's a small group who only wants that, right? But there's a much bigger group for whom even that has to be a stepping stone. Look, as a low-income student, if you need to get income to help your family or to move this forward, the question and what we have to watch in all of this is that we aren't taking low-income students who disproportionately are Black and Latino in this country, and getting them into what are low-wage programs, right? So when you look at who, you know, look at the ethnic diversity on most college campuses between cosmetology and nursing, right? And not to say cosmetology is a bad program, but if we disproportionately have low-income students going into cosmetology and they're gonna make $22,000 a year, they can never make more than 24, we have to ask ourselves from an economic mobility standpoint, are we doing those students a favor? And by the way, $24,000 sounds like a lot of money to a 19-year-old. But when you're 30 with two kids, it's not a lot of money. Even maybe the cost of living is a little lower here, but it's not anywhere in a lot of money. So I think we have to walk the line between how we talk about those things. I'm a segmentation guy, so we need to know how many students are quote unquote just here to do those certifications. But I think the national definition of completion usually is a certificate of 1 year or more, an AA degree or transfer. But this debate is a very fair one, exploration of this. And I think there's a lot of nuance. It may be that Chandler-Gilbert has more of these students than say Glendon or Mesa. There has to be nuance in these discussions. So thank you for bringing it up, because it's an important discussion. I think the point is, I think as Chris brings up, is where you see success, you see it in places where we have a lot of structure, right? We have someone at the institution who's monitoring student progress. If you're in one of those programs, someone's watching out for you. I'm from psychology, my degree's in social psychology, so I always use psychology as an example. Not because there's anything particularly wrong in that discipline. But if you were to go take 10 psych students out of a class and ask them how if they knew where they were in their overall progression to the college, you'd likely find that 1, 2, or maybe 3 of them have any idea, if they're lucky. You take a search tech or an aviation student now, they can tell you exactly where they are, exactly what they're doing, how they're going. So, and they also have someone who's there for them. Like the psych student, you could leave like halfway through the semester or after the end of the semester, no one ever knows. Right, you're in aviation, that guy's like asking you questions, he knew you were in trouble before you did. So we'll get to the big ideas, the guided pathways that build on this. So this is a graphic we came up with on the latest national project. I worked on that AECC project, and I think it does a pretty good job of just quickly displaying the big ideas, the guided pathways are in green. There's some planning conditions that have to be in place. We talk about leadership, we talk about resources, we talk about a commitment to data, understanding where you are today. Colleges each filled out a scale with option tool that CCRC developed and said, hey, where are we today at Chandler-Gilbert on some of these big ideas and guided pathways? It's really helpful to know that to help build forward. And this is long term. Like, you can't do this in 6 months. You can't do it. I like to say you can't put someone on the back of campus in a trailer and say you're working on guided pathways and then the rest of us just go back and do the same thing. You saw it in the slides from the district. This is everyone working together. It's student services, it's faculty, it's administration. This is gonna, when we're trying to change these big ideas, it's gonna take that much. We can talk about some of the outcomes, although these are the four big ideas. We're gonna clarify the paths between, we're gonna map programs, we're gonna tell students what to take to get to where they wanna go. You wanna be in psychology at ASU? Well, guess what? You're happen to be of land, if you come into Maricopa, one of the very few places in the country that has really good transfer pathways. Probably the best in the country. There's probably too many of them, but 252 is a lot, but you have very, very good transfer pathways with ASU. You're seen as a national model on this front for having juniors standing the major. Because let's be clear, when we talk about transfer, we're not talking about just transfer. We're talking about transferring with juniors standing in a major, which is very different, as you advisors especially know. That's a big difference, right? And the Maricopa maps help with that a lot. It's not perfect, we know that. But many other colleges in the country are dealing with a couple things. Like, we know that, you know, two-thirds of your colleges, two-thirds of your students who transfer go to ASU. But the NAU and U of A discussion, you know very well that if someone's going to go in psych to one of those three schools, there are some differences in what they would have to take for junior standing in a major. So that's part of, you know, even though you have a really strong map to ASU, I think it's great to use it as a default because it's where most of your students are going. It's still work to be done in other places. So the class has to be clarified. We've got to help students get on the path. What does that mean? Well, it means we've got to help them figure out what they want to do. We're very fond of saying, historically, every college I ever worked at did this, all these students are undecided. They don't know what they want to do. How can we get them on a path? To which I say, why are we surprised they're undecided? What have we done to actually help them decide anything? Career exploration, wonderful idea. Where do we do it now? If someone happens to land, and you're, I'm sure you have great career services people, happen to land in their office, great, right? But for the most part, most students don't get that. And if they do, it's not early enough to help them make a decision. You shouldn't be asking about careers in your last semester. You should have been thinking about that when you picked your program, right? That's when it matters. And so that's a big deal to move that earlier. The other thing about helping students get on a path is DevEd reform. Not a single one of the students, one of the 125,000 students who come to Maricopa, came here to major in DevEd. It's not actually something that they want to do. And by the way, I love math and English people. There are none in the room. If there were, I would say the same thing. I love math and English faculty. They're good people. But we also have to stop acting as if math and English is the ultimate destination of all of our students. What, 4% of them are going to major in math or English? Right? That doesn't mean math and English aren't important. But what it might mean is that math and English are important in the service of something else the student wants to do. And if students are in long DevEd sequences, they're never getting a path. Right? So you guys have got some good stuff going on in this district with some acceleration and co-rec that's working on that. First-year experiences, mandatory advising, case management advising, all of that helps up here. Help students stay on the path. This probably is most in the kind of purview of advisors, but it's also faculty in the classroom helping with students staying on the path as well. And then we got to ensure that they're learning the things we say they're learning. What I like about the program mapping, the early program mapping work that's happened here in Maricopa, is it's based in learning. And I will tell you, that's actually not that common. I mean, it should be more common. And I think your folks here, some of the early, Steve and
Jennifer,
right. Thank you, Jennifer Fry, that's right. I've done some really good work on this. I mean, that process needs to be spread throughout the district, but you guys have done some good work here. Any questions about the big ideas? What I'm going to do now is go through each one of them individually and let you guys ask questions and see some examples from some colleges that have gone pretty far on this. Any questions at this point, though? All right, let's get in there. We can see some. So just kind of from CCRC. So one of the big ideas, and by the way, the term meta-majors is not one we actually want to use, but one of the ideas that we talk about is that when students come into the institution, you guys have, what, 300 majors, 200 and some odd majors? There's a lot. It's dizzying to decide between that many things. So one of the things that we talk about is having, rather than choosing between 200 and some odd programs, that I'm just going to use the term academic and career institutes, just because I think it's better than meta-majors. Maybe the idea when you come in is that not you choose between 300 programs, but you choose between 8 kind of big areas: business, social science, natural science, allied health, humanities, and we create an experience for you so that in your first semester or your first 2 semesters, you're exploring within that area, but also staying perfectly on path to all the degrees that come after it, right? So the program maps align with the meta majors, so that if you're in the business meta major, as an example, you're taking courses in your first semester, maybe your first 2 semesters, that keep everything open in business after those first 2 semesters. And then we do some things to help you figure out, do you want to be in accounting? Do you want to be in international business? Do you want to be in entrepreneurship? And hopefully we designed it so that that path is clear no matter what you took in the meta major in the first semester. Trying to get everyone a full program plan by the end of term one. Day one's kind of hard on this, but by the end of term one, the hope is we've given you enough career exploration, enough advising, a first semester experience, where you can make an informed decision about what path you want to be on. Make schedules and monitor progress based on student plans. So this is one of the more controversial things that that's in here, and I'll say it probably a lot in the next 4 days, is that we all know how we've done schedule, many deans in the room. We all know how we've scheduled historically, right? Which is get the last, so I'm a social science dean, because I used to do that. I get the last fall schedule. I say, all right, anyone want to change anything this fall? Right? Beth says, I want to teach at 10. Chris says, I want to teach at 8. Cool, you guys switch, no problem. Problem with that is, you may have just taken two courses that were on different parts of people's, what they needed, offered them at times that made it impossible for a student to get the courses they needed. We've never scheduled based on what students need to get to where they want. Now we do it in the CTE programs. No surge tech students ever have a problem putting something together, right? Because we did it. We figured it out for them. That's one of the big ideas of guided pathways, is that once you get the program plans and you know what students need to take, and look, this is just be really clear. For 50, 60 years in community colleges, we've hired faculty under a model where you kind of get to teach what you want to teach in your discipline, when you want to teach it. And I want to be really clear, that is a model that we hired people under. I don't begrudge faculty that model, because that's what we did. But we're kind of changing the game a little now. We're not changing it on a whim. We're changing it because that doesn't work for students. And it's a different frame to say, hey, what do students need to take to get to where they want to go? And by the way, when do we have to offer it so they can actually put a schedule together? That's a very different scheduling mindset. It, by the way, will not be the first thing you fix in this. Because scheduling is very ingrained, has a lot of history, and that will take a little while to get to the point where you can have the schedules working. I would guess it's probably not as big of a deal at Maricopa. I'm hoping because of the transfer pathway, but maybe it is. You guys can tell me on that front. Academic support. I mean, advising, one of the big tenets of this model is that we do more case management advising. Can we do that with 17 to 100 to 1 student ratios? Of course not, right? And I know the district has some funds for advising that are hopefully being freed up to come down the path to help with this. Experiential learning, we're trying to get learning within the program that involves experiences that make it better for students. We gotta build pathways back into high school. So these are some of the big ideas. So let's talk about the clarifying the path. Here's the big shifts in clarifying the path. The old model is when, yeah.
So can you go back a second?
Absolutely.
So you said making the schedule and monitoring the process based on the statement of plans. So how do we figure that out? Because we might take a survey from our students, and they might say we want hybrid, or we want online. And then they might say, and it doesn't always work that way.
Right, so you're not gonna have unlimited options, right? And at some point, so you're talking, the online hybrid face-to-face thing is a tricky kind of subset of this, right? You're gonna have groups, so if you have 800 students trying to do a program, you're gonna try to get a default schedule that works for 75 of them. There's gonna be 25 whose work schedule or life schedule, it's just not gonna work the way one of the interesting things that comes down the road here, depending on the program, that may be something that helps that student choose a different program. Like, for example, you've done this already. Like, when does aviation meet? When are the classes in aviation? 8 to 5?
No. 8 to
1:30
and 4 to
9:30. Yeah. Now, why do you know that closely? Like,
because that's what they tell me.
Okay. But I'm wondering if someone made the decision, that means they could work between, like, you know what I'm getting at here, right? If a student knows that ahead of time, now they can make a decision about whether they can do that. Like, if there's classes 4 to 9:30, 4 days a week, that's kind of a big, where are you working 5 days a week, right? So, and unless you can find a job where you work from, 12:30 to 2:30, right? So that's a specific case where you know that student knows coming in, I can't do this if I have to work X number of hours a week. So the hybrid online thing, I think, is an interesting, how do we use hybrid online to help fill holes in schedules? I think this is a seventh and eighth level process in this, because now let's be honest, we haven't used hybrid and online to do that historically. We've used hybrid online normally to see what will fill from an enrollment standpoint. Like, what can we offer online that people will take? That's very different from what do they need to get to where they want to go. So I think it's a mindset we haven't necessarily applied, particularly to online courses. And we also, I would argue historically, didn't always look at online courses with a, should this course be taught online? And where does it fit within the pathway? Rather than I have a faculty who wants to teach it online and I think students will sign up for it. So that's a different mindset, yeah.
Just to add to that, Beth and I were just talking, we put it online, it's going to fill.
Right.
Yeah, so there's that idea, you can get a little bit more.
Yeah.
Even as sometimes you were questioning, is this the best way?
Right, and so, I mean, and look, we've all been dealing with enrollment crunches the last, especially 5-6 years. And so in those times, what we tend to do is the short-term fix model of, by the way, this is why dual enrollment in this country has crept up to be as large. There are places where it's 40-45% of enrollment in the college. And look, if that was all program-based dual enrollment that was leading to a clear outcome, great. What it is in a lot of places is random course taking, like the high school astronomy teacher retires, and they don't want to teach astronomy, or hire a teacher who can do it, so they say, hey, can you teach the astronomy? You say, sure, I get enrollment, you get enrollment, we're all happy. But one of the problems with dual enrollment is, look, we're going to say in a second, one of the problems we wrestle with in our world, the community college world, is what we call the cafeteria model, right? That you just kind of pick all this stuff in random, it's total chaos. Well, if we just move that into the high schools and do it earlier, it's like you're taking the same chaos we have a problem with and pushing it back into the high schools, which makes these pathways even harder. Like students come to us with a mishmash of credits. Now the advisor's trying to figure out how to get something to work with it. You've taken four courses that have absolutely nothing to do with each other. We just happen to offer them. So the online thing, we do have to rethink what we have online, where it fits. I think it's a very tricky part of the program mapping process is what courses should be online, could be online. Are we talking programs? Are we talking pieces of programs? There's a lot to work out there. And because we know we would fill, from an enrollment management standpoint, the bet we're making here is by getting more students onto pathways, more of them are going to stay and complete, which will solve the enrollment problem in a different way. But it's a very good point because we know they'll fill them, right? You had your hand back up again.
Well, just because, I mean, we know that yes, if we put English online, it'll fill, but then what's the drop rate? Because even in, in my class, they don't understand how to use computers. I mean,
right.
I do Ask a Librarian on Mondays, and I have a student asking me, how do I get to my online class?
Yeah.
And I'm like, whoa, okay, let me figure out how to write this to go to my Maricopa. And so I'm chatting with the student because he's desperately trying to get to his online class, and he doesn't know where to go.
Yeah, so colleges have dealt with that particular problem in a number of ways. Some places have required online orientation for online classes. Others pull that back into the front on the onboarding of a new student in some sort of mandatory orientation where we're actually learning. I don't know if you guys, do you guys have mandatory orientation now, or is it still?
I've been told I can't do online orientation, like a mandatory orientation of my online class because it switches it. If I want to just bring my students in one time,
say that again.
If they have to come in during the week,
that doesn't mean you can't do an online orientation.
Well, you can, but they don't. The problem is they don't have to get to online. I mean, they don't.
Oh, I see. Chicken and the egg problem. I got there. So the question is, there's a lot of ways to deal with that particular problem. I think your overall orientation to coming to college would be the highly recommended place to do that, to spend half an hour of how do you get into the portal, how do you get online. It's interesting when you go ahead.
So we do what we call Hiring Kickoff, which is a mandatory new student orientation for new students.
Right.
So that's great. We could maybe incorporate that into that, have a part of that. But we also have a lot of students that if they're not a new student, we don't require them to.
Yeah, so I think there's a variety of solutions to this problem that have been tried out there. I think we can certainly share to get some of the ones with you. I think some sort of drop-in lab that helps people do that. One of the problems is students don't know how to get the help. Like that student happened to find you. But if we had a place where it said, if you don't know how to do this, call X, come here, email Y. Like if they're chat with Z, like there's multimodal ways to get kind of the help you need. I mean, I think there's various ways of getting at this issue. So let's mess around with some of the stuff in this pillar. Look, when colleges come to us and they see, what do? We give them like an alphabetical program list of all the programs. Again, we mentioned the idea of academic and career communities or meta majors. Rather than students with 300, you choose maybe 6 to 10. A la carte distributions and requirements and electives. Rather than doing that, we're gonna move to a model. Program maps, course sequences, critical courses, co-curricular requirements. Algebra is the default math path, right? Rather than actually having program and field-specific math paths. This is obviously a big shift of the last decade. 10 years ago, most colleges and a lot of math faculty within colleges really opposed this idea that something aside from algebra could be transfer-level math. Now, I used to teach multivariate statistics, but I did it from the psychology side, so I'm not a mathematician, but I have a lot of mathematician friends who say, look, we all know that algebra only exists for one reason, which is to help people on the path, the multi-course path, be ready for calculus, which most of us do not need, right? How many of you factored polynomials recently? Doesn't happen, right? And so the thing with the math pathway thing, I think we've really gone a long way in 10 years. I know you guys have some good work on this in this district as well. But if you're going into psychology, you don't need the math and the algebra sequence unless you're going into cognitive or neuropsych. You're in clinical, developmental, social, behavioral, psych, MFCCs. We're talking quantitative reasoning or statistics. And this is a big shift. And by the way, I think one of the reasons Dev Ed reform didn't work so well for a long time is it was done independent of guided pathways, right? If you're going to do alternate math pathways, you can't do that without knowing what a student's trying to do, right? So what we did historically is just assume we should keep all their options open, so we put them in the algebra sequence, which is, by the way, the one that very few students ever got out of. So we defaulted by keeping their options open to a model that worked maybe 20% of the time for students. Not bad people, just a system that wasn't working for students. So this is a big shift on the math side. The idea of certificates and degrees was, this is, I think, you're kind of getting to the point. What are degree pathways that have embedded certificates and certifications? And I always stop here because I think I would add to this with market value. Because one of the things we see in states, and you guys don't have to worry about this, is you don't get the apportionment from the state. But where you have state apportionment, you start to see performance funding models that are like rewarding certificates. Well, now all of a sudden, everyone's got a certificate in everything, right? Hey, you've got a certificate for completing one quarter of your psychology AA. Yeah, that's great. Now you can really show that to someone. I've completed one quarter of my psychology AA. By the way, you can show them the AA in psychology. That isn't going to do anything either. You need a bachelor's or a master's or, you know. So we do, I think it's really important that they're with market value. And then connections to careers and transfer are unclear to actually doing this early on. Whether you're in the first of 9 years of 3 degrees in psychology or you're in the certification for Cisco, right? Both of those students are career focused. I do this little thing where I ask big rooms of faculty, how many of your students are in your classroom solely for the love of learning? Out of 100. Yeah, that is out of 100. Yeah, it's probably 3. It's actually closer to 0. If you give students a list of the 10 reasons they're here and put love of learning on it, one of my friends in Alamo in Texas did this. She came up and said, I've been teaching econ, macro econ for 15 years. I've had this survey question on my opening day, like a little survey, why are you here at Alamo? And she listed 10 responses. One of them was for the love of learning. And I said, oh, cool, real data. What percentage of them chose that? She said, percentage? No one's chosen it in 15 years. I'm like, wow, that is depressing but realistic. I did the math. It was 3,500 students she had seen and given the survey. Not one of them chose for the love of learning. What's the primary reason you're here at the college? Now, that doesn't mean we shouldn't try to catalyze the love of learning in people while they're here, but that's not why they're here, right? They're here to get somewhere. They're here because they've been told, and largely this is true, that this is a stepping stone to a better life and a living wage and economic mobility, right? We've got to deliver on that. So these are the big ideas. Any questions about these big ideas for mapping? Just to show you some examples now from, this is like, here, this looks familiar, it's not yours. This is the old school model, right, where you just list programs. Here's 800 programs, you list them all. And maybe this is a little easier to deal with, right, where we see, this is Indian River State College. I want to be really clear, although these are website screenshots, this is not about web design. It's about business processes, it's about structures, it's about cultures that the website now displays. But the work is not about web design here. But this, I'm a new student, I'd much rather look at this than this. Right? I mean, what do we know about choice? Where do we get paralyzed in human choice? Somewhere between 3 and 7 choices, we can handle anything over 7, we're screwed. That's a problem, right? Think of how long it would take to click through on each one of these and try to learn something about it. Just do the math. Like 10 minutes each, there's 200 minutes, 2,000 minutes. What's that, 35 hours of searching to look through all the programs? I mean, it's crazy. This is a little easier, like to see, all right, here's, we've got arts, humanities, design, business, education. We've got a bunch of different areas here. And if you pick one, science, technology, engineering, and math, hey, now you see those same programs that were on this list, but they're organized now. Now I can see some things I want to do. Maybe I click on one of these. Which one is this? Computer information technology, down from the AS degree. here's the various certificates and degrees in here, here's the kind of career coach jobs and salary, here's our guided pathways. You click on any one of this, you get the guided pathway for a full-time student. Down here, you get it for part-time students. Boom, you're doing 2-3 clicks. You're seeing, here's what I gotta take in Indian River to get my AA in Information Technology Management and Cybersecurity. Lists the courses, it lists prerequisites. It, by the way, they're using summer, which is interesting. They're basically saying, hey, you're gonna get through this in 2 years? We gotta use summer. Here's what you're gonna take. Final courses there. It talks about, here's all the jobs that you can get. You can click through on these jobs, you learn about salary, right? All this information in packaged ways that millennial students especially are used to seeing. Here's another example from St. Petersburg. Rather than having the 8 ideas, they have the wheel here, which I think, it always is rough if you're down at the bottom of the wheel. I don't know who reads these. I think it's interesting that through arts, humanities, and dying, and social sciences down here, I think this is like a very insulting kind of, like, no one's doing that anyway, put them upside down. Actually, that's what most students are doing. But this is kind of cool. So it's got sample careers in here, it's got salaries. You click through on one of these, you see more information. Here's our technology degrees at St. Petersburg. Here's your pathway. They do theirs a little different. They first list it in order of what you need to take, and then they break it into semesters based on whether you're full-time or part-time. By the way, here's your embedded certifications and certificates right here. So each blue stage is an embedded. And I love that they do this so you see it all. So you see that when you're done with your, all right, this is not where you stop. This can maybe get you that next job, but you have this whole range here. Here's, and now they're with University of South Florida is their transfer partner there, your Maricopa. And with USF, they've got the USF courses. Here's what you take at St. Petersburg in the first 2 years. Here's what you take at USF in the third year. 2+2, boom, right? You guys have versions of this with all of your maps with ASU, which I think are good. Here's why I like this visual from St. Petersburg. Now we're gonna do it for a full-time student in engineering tech. We've got what you need to take. This over here are things like visit career services, explore degree options, familiar yourself with my SBC. So this is starting to get, some of the things that would be on this list would be like learn how to get into the portal, right? And they have things on the back end to support this. So it's a combination of not only course taking, but the things that you need to do outside the classroom, the co-curricular things as well, which I think are cool. Here's another one from Macomb in Michigan. This is their version of kind of meta majors. They call them areas of interest. Get into science and math. Here's biological sciences. Gets you over to life and physical sciences, talks about jobs. Note that a lot of these, the connections to career are very clear, right? They're making this early on. So whether or not you're in biological sciences, which is kind of a classic pre-allied health or pre-education major, we're gonna show you what are the jobs that are out here. Kind of technician jobs all the way up to aerospace engineer. What I love about this with Macomb is they're not saying, okay, CTE, you go to this part of the website, transfer and, this is so insulting, academic, you're over here, right? It's all together. These are just different aspects of the same industry. You can be an agricultural food science tech, or you can be a medical scientist, right? And this is trying to deal with a problem if we tend to siphon off people, okay, well, you're poor, you need money, let's get you over here to these short-term things. And by the way, all you well-off people who have time and money, you can be an aerospace engineer. Let's put it all together so that everyone sees what the possibilities are within this area. I love that about this. Employment outlook, transferring is easy. They're focused on that. Here's your exploring your career options version. They've got that for undecided down here. I don't love undecided as a meta major. Like, I don't love the fact that we're just gonna take the same undecided problem we have and put it in and kind of concretize it. But I love that what they're doing for this is providing more services for those who are undecided, not less. There's another college, Monroe in New York, who went down this path and said, all right, we're gonna help an undecided meta major, but you have to take an additional required class if you're undecided to help you decide. Kind of like that idea. If you're really going to be undecided, let's help you figure this out. How else are you going to figure it out? We've made this assumption historically that somehow random course taking is the way to figure out what you want to do. By the way, from an efficiency standpoint, it makes no sense. But just from a logic standpoint, how does taking Psych 1 help you figure out if you want to be a psychologist? It's a survey course, right? You don't learn anything in Poli-Sci 1 about what it means to be a political scientist. You learn to survey stuff in political science. So it already takes something different than course taking to figure this out. Let's call that out and actually do it. Let's help people. And it's a combination of advising, career, faculty and classroom serving a slightly different role. Further exploring the pathways here. This is Northeast Wisconsin. It's got some other. So you see, there's various versions of these. This is their transfer orientation distribution logistics program. Earning potential median down here, like $40,000 goes a long way in Green Bay. Getting that supply chain management, employment potential, program entry requirements. This is a little more CTE type program. Very clear what you're taking, including GE. One of the things we get from CTE programs about guided pathways is, well, we're already doing this. Well, you're doing maybe three quarters of it, but there are some CTE programs that go as far as saying, all right, here's your default electives you need to take for the gen ed side, and others that just kind of leave it. We're kind of shooting for where we're doing this all together. This is actually kind of cool, the math thing from San Jacinto in Texas. They actually created a survey for faculty and other programs to figure out which math course was right for their program. So rather than just having them pick randomly, like, do you need to summarize and interpret data? Which of the, do you need to apply logic and reasoning? They take this and actually help the other faculty figure out what's the right math course for their program, which I thought was really cool. So they basically, they end up after this with these degrees. Here's the required math course. Here's math for business and social sciences, math for liberal arts. Hey, chemistry, you need college algebra. Cool, now we know that. All right, any questions about those, that section, the kind of mapping of the pathways, the pillars, observations?
I'm gonna sit down for a second.
I think there's a little bit more understanding this observation. You said CTE programs are mostly there, but maybe there's a little bit more
yeah.
to be done to best serve students is what you're getting at?
Two things there, I would say. One is that getting into, there's a huge guided pathways issues with selective programs. So when you're talking about nursing, by the way, the nursing program, highly structured, they tell you exactly what to take in what order. The selectivity, however, creates a different guided pathways problem, which is that at most community colleges, as Chandler-Gilbert has nursing here, right? How many students in the nursing program a year?
We have four blocks of 40 students.
Four blocks of 40? 160 students. How many students at Chandler-Gilbert think they're pre-nursing?
1,000.
By the way, it's unbelievable how often we just multiply the number times 10. So if it's 160 and 60. And by the way, if you look at the data at a lot of community colleges, that multiplying by 10 is about right. If you look at pre-allied health students who are clearly on a nursing path and you look at the data, get your IR person to mess with it, you'll find it's somewhere between 8 to 10 times as many students are trying to get into nursing as are actually getting into nursing, which causes the question, what happens to the other 12, 1300, right? Now this is not nursing faculty's problem. Right? This is our issue. So this is the guided pathway side of selective programs. When we want the third pillar is how do you keep students on the path? Well, guess what? I bet if you went and measured it right now, you'd find, let's see, let's do the numbers here, 700-800 students who have a GPA that's somewhere below 2.8, 2.7, who are never getting into your nursing program, but think they're pre-nursing. Right? So they're merely going on taking courses, thinking they're gonna get into nursing, racking up student loan debt, not making progress or anything. So that's a big guided pathways issue. What do we do for access to them? There's some answers to that if we have time, I can go into them, but you know, you can make sure that when you're monitoring pre-nursing students to see when they get to that point, can we make sure we kind of counsel them into a different program? You can create some degrees that actually have market value that help catch those students. That's one. From a mapping standpoint though, the big issue for, and it's not necessarily for the nursing type programs, but on some programs you have, all right, the discipline courses are really clear. So let's just take auto tech for a second and say that the A, is it an AA here, AS was in auto? AS, was it?
We don't have it.
So assuming you did, like AS and auto tech is, there are certain auto tech programs which not only tell you what are the 13 classes you need to take in auto, but also take the other 8 or 9 classes you need on Gen Ed and put them on a pathway so you know exactly when to take them in what order. That's the desired goal. There are other programs that say, here's your 13 courses in auto, figure out your Gen Eds. So what we see there is people don't get the AA. And it sometimes is okay in the short term because they can get a job when they get the certification, right? On the auto side, they get the Toyota engine certification, like, cool, I can do this. The problem is their upward mobility has really been cut by not getting a degree. And so then there's also other CTE programs who are currently certificates that would actually rather have an AA degree in it. But the reason they don't is because they haven't been able to have Gen Ed work with them, the kind of Gen Ed side of the house, to kind of customize or contextualize Gen Ed courses for the program to make it an AA degree. or an AS degree. So those are the issues on the CTE side that we have to wrestle with. But let's be clear, for most of our CTE programs, they are between 70 and 80% of the way there. It's more about onboarding into the programs. Some of your less enrolled CTE programs, it's about recruiting differently and people finding out about those programs. So these meta majors are kind of cool for one purpose, is that, go back to that one, can you go back to the one that I liked a lot? Where was that? The one that had them all on the same page. What I like about those areas there on the right is that people can see the possibilities for getting into different parts of this of the program. And I lost my train of thought there. I don't know where I was going with that. It's early in the week to do that. Usually that's a Friday thing.
You're talking about the advertising going
on. Oh, thank you. Thank you. I really lost as I was looking for that. It's just completely, I need more caffeine. Yeah, so now you know, by the way, when you look at this page, there's a range of options here. I don't know what, by the way, I have absolutely no idea what a life, physical, and social sciences technician is. But I can click on that and find out. Maybe it's a job I can get in the short term as I'm working towards a long-term job in life sciences. So now you actually get some recruiting. And by the way, this is also recruiting for some more esoteric programs. Like, we talk about, often people come and say, hey, what about our program in geology? What happens to our geology program? I'm like, well, how the hell does someone find your geology program now? Like, random chance that was the only class open that they end up in geology? Like, if geology was on this, which it could be, by the way, in the life of physical sciences, people might actually know about it. If you do a good job tying what the careers are in geology, like, and we actually might get more people to major in some of these esoteric things that we don't have a lot of. By the way, those classes are often the ones we have trouble filling, right? Geology may not be a program in your college. It may be one option of a life science gen ed. That's fine if that's the case, but sometimes we have these kind of struggling programs that also don't get straight very well either. Any other questions about the mapping one? And again, you guys have some folks working on this already, but it's early. They've done some good work with a certain set of maps. They still need to be vetted across the district. Second one, now we're talking onboarding. How do we bring students into the institution? Well, here's something we used to do. Job and transfer support for near completers. You're almost done. Well, let's figure out your transfer or what job you might be able to get, which, as you know, is a huge problem, right? Both sides, it's a huge problem. The job side, they may not want the job that's there, they may not be market for it. But on the transfer side, I mean, I think you guys have a better story here with the maps and ASU. But if someone has wanted to go to UCLA this entire time, that's been their goal, when to figure out you need to take these six courses instead of those six courses is not in your last semester of sciences, which is kind of a classic pre-allied health or pre-education major. We're gonna show you one of the jobs that are out here. It's kind of technician jobs all the way up to aerospace engineer. What I love about this with McComb is they're not saying, okay, CTE, you go to this part of the website, transfer, and this is so insulting, academic, you're over here, right? It's all together. These are just different aspects of the same industry. You can be an agricultural food science tech, or you can be a medical scientist, right? And this is trying to deal with a problem if we tend to siphon off people, okay, well, you're poor, you need money, let's get you over here to these short-term things. And by the way, all you well-off people who have time and money, you can be an aerospace engineer. Let's put it all together so that everyone sees what the possibilities are within this area. I love that about this. Employment outlook, transferring is easy. They're focused on that. Here's your exploring your career options version. They've got that for undecided down here. I don't love undecided as a meta major. Like, I don't love the fact that we're just going to take the same undecided problem we have and put it in and kind of concretize it. But I love that what they're doing for this is providing more services for those who are undecided, not less. There's another college, Monroe, in New York, who went down this path and said, all right, we're going to help an undecided meta major, but you have to take an additional required class if you're undecided to help you decide. Kind of like that idea. If you're really going to be undecided, let's help you figure this out. How else are you going to figure it out? We've made this assumption historically that somehow random course taking is the way to figure out what you want to do. By the way, from an efficiency standpoint, it makes no sense. But just from a logic standpoint, how does taking Psych 1 help you figure out if you want to be a psychologist? It's a survey course, right? You don't learn anything in poli-sci 1 about what it means to be a political scientist. You learn to survey stuff in political science. So it already takes something different than course taking to figure this out. Let's call that out and actually do it. Let's help people. And it's a combination of advising, career, faculty, and classroom serving a slightly different role. Further exploring the pathways here, This is Northeast Wisconsin. It's got some other. So you see, there's various versions of these. This is their transfer orientation distribution logistics program. Earning potential median down here at like $40,000 goes a long way in Green Bay. Getting down supply chain management, employment potential, program entry requirements. This is a little more CTE type program. Very clear what you're taking, including GE. One of the things we get from CTE programs about guided pathways is, well, we're already doing this. Well, you're doing maybe three quarters of it, but there are some CTE programs that go as far as saying, all right, here's your default electives you need to take for the gen ed side, and others that just kind of leave it. We're kind of shooting for where we're doing this all together. This is actually kind of cool, the math thing from San Jacinto in Texas. They actually created a survey for faculty and other programs to figure out which math course was right for their program. So rather than just having them pick randomly, like, do you need to summarize and interpret data? Which of the, do you need to apply logic and reasoning? They take this and actually help the other faculty figure out what's the right math course for their program, which I thought was really cool. So they basically, they end up after this with these degrees. Here's the required math course. Here's math for business and social sciences, math for liberal arts. Hey, chemistry, you need college algebra. Cool, now we know that. All right, any questions about those, that section, the kind of mapping of the pathways, the pillars, observations?
I'm gonna sit down for a second.
I think there's a little bit more understanding this observation. You said CTE programs are mostly there, but maybe there's a little bit more
yeah.
to be done to best serve students is what you're getting at?
Two things there, I would say. One is that getting into, there's a huge guided pathways issues with selective programs. So when you're talking about nursing, by the way, the nursing program, highly structured, they tell you exactly what to take in what order. The selectivity, however, creates a different guided pathways problem, which is that at most community colleges, as Chandler-Gilbert has nursing here, right? How many students in the nursing program a year?
We have four blocks of 40 students.
4 blocks of 40? 160 students. How many students at Chandler-Gilbert think they're pre-nursing?
1,000.
By the way, it's unbelievable how often we just multiply the number times 10. So if it's 160 and 60. And by the way, if you look at the data at a lot of community colleges, that multiplying by 10 is about right. If you look at pre-allied health students who are clearly on a nursing path and you look at the data, get your IR person to mess with it, you'll find it's somewhere between 8 to 10 times as many students are trying to get into nursing as are actually getting into nursing, which causes the question, what happens to the other 12, 1300, right? Now this is not nursing faculty's problem. Right? This is our issue. So this is the guided pathway side of selective programs. When we want the third pillar is how do you keep students on the path? Well, guess what? I bet if you went and measured it right now, you'd find, let's see, let's do the numbers here, 700-800 students who have a GPA that's somewhere below 2.8, 2.7, who are never getting into your nursing program, but think they're pre-nursing. Right? So they're merely going on taking courses, thinking they're gonna get into nursing, racking up student loan debt, not making progress or anything. So that's a big guided pathway issue. What do we do for access to them? There's some answers to that. If we have time, I can go into them. But you know, you can make sure that when you're monitoring pre-nursing students to see when they get to that point, can we make sure we kind of counsel them into a different program? You can create some degrees that actually have market value that help catch those students. That's one. From a mapping standpoint, though, the big issue for, and it's not necessarily for the nursing type programs, but on some programs, you have, all right, the discipline courses are really clear. So let's just take auto tech for a second and say that the AA, is it an AA here? AS was in auto? AS. Was it?
We don't have it.
So assuming you did, like AS and auto tech, is, there are certain auto tech programs which not only tell you what are the 13 classes you need to take in auto, but also take the other 8 or 9 classes you need on gen ed and put them on a pathway so you know exactly when to take them in what order. That's the desired goal. There are other programs that say, here's your 13 courses in auto, figure out your gen eds. So what we see there is people don't get the AA. And it sometimes is okay in the short term because they can get a job when they get the certification, right? On the auto side, they get the Toyota engine certification, like, cool, I can do this. The problem is their upward mobility has really been cut by not getting a degree. And so then there's also other CTE programs who are currently certificates. They would actually rather have an AA degree in it, but the reason they don't is because they haven't been able to have gen ed work with them, the kind of gen ed side of the house, to kind of customize or contextualize gen ed courses for the program to make it an AA degree. or an AS degree. So those are the issues on the CTE side that we have to wrestle with. But let's be clear, for most of our CTE programs, they are between 70 and 80% of the way there. It's more about onboarding into the programs. Some of your less enrolled CTE programs, it's about recruiting differently and people finding out about those programs. So these meta majors are kind of cool for one purpose, is that, go back to that one, all on the same page. What I like about those areas there on the right is that people can see the possibilities for getting into different parts of this of the program. And I lost my train of thought there. I don't know where I was going with that. It's early in the week to do that. Usually that's a Friday thing.
You're talking about the advertising going
on. Oh, thank you. Thank you. I really lost that. I was looking for that to just completely, I need more caffeine. Yeah, so now you know, by the way, when you look at this page, there's a range of options here. I don't know what, by the way, I have absolutely no idea what a life, physical, and social sciences technician is. But I can click on that and find out. Maybe it's a job I can get in the short term as I'm working towards a long-term job in life sciences. So now you actually get some recruiting. And by the way, this is also recruiting for some more esoteric programs. Like, we talk about, often people come and say, hey, what about our program in geology? What happens to our geology program? I'm like, well, how the hell does someone find your geology program now? Like, random chance that was the only class open that they end up in geology. Like, if geology was on this, which it could be, by the way, in the life of physical sciences, people might actually know about it. If you do a good job tying what the careers are in geology, like, and we actually might get more people to major in some of these esoteric things that we don't have a lot of. By the way, those classes are often the ones we have trouble filling, right? Geology may not be a program in your college. It may be one option of a life science gen ed. That's fine if that's the case, but sometimes we have these kind of struggling programs that also don't get straight very well either. Any other questions about the mapping one? And again, you guys have some folks working on this already, but it's early. They've done some good work with a certain set of maps. They still need to be vetted across the district. Second one, now we're talking onboarding. How do we bring students into the institution? Well, here's something we used to do. Job and transfer support for near completers. You're almost done. Well, let's figure out your transfer or what job you might be able to get, which, as you know, is a huge problem, right? Both sides, it's a huge problem. The job side, they may not want the job that's there, they may not be market for it. But on the transfer side, I mean, I think you guys have a better story here with the MAPS and ASU. But if someone has wanted to go to UCLA this entire time, that's been their goal, when to figure out you need to take these six courses instead of those six courses is not in your last semester. It's before that. We need to actually have career and college exploration and planning for everyone from the start. And we do need it, even in Arizona, where you have the three big players of NAU, U of A, and ASU. You guys know that there are differences on those paths. And the earlier a student makes a decision about that, the more likely they are going to be on that path. I mean, I do think you probably have the option of defaulting to ASU because so many of your students transfer there. But if a student wants to be in Flagstaff, well, then let's figure out what the pathway is to psychology at Flagstaff or biology at U of A, which is probably slightly different than it is at ASU. That's what I've been told, at least in the district. How about, rather than thinking about, hey, what's my next semester of courses, a full program plan like we saw in the early one. This is a big advising deal, right? Because you only have your advisors in the room. No, but how much time do you have with a new student? 20, 30 minutes if you're lucky. It's really hard to do anything. I mean, it's ridiculous what you're supposed to do in those 30 minutes. Like, talk to them about their hopes and dreams, all of their skills, like their academic history, like figure out job. I mean, it's preposterous, right? You can't have that in a 30-minute session. So what we've done historically is, all right, say, cool, here's one semester of courses. Come back and see us. We'll figure this out. Problem with that is they don't come back. Or the ones who need it the most don't come back. And the rest kind of wander their way through the curriculum. It's why a lot of places require advising now. I mean, 25-30% of colleges have some sort of required advising either every semester or a check-in at 15 and 30 units to make sure you're staying on path. But this idea of full program plans would help with this. There's some colleges, by the way, going to full program year-long schedules. So you say you're in the biology transfer program to ASU, you get one code. It gives you two semesters of a full-time schedule. It won't work for all students, but hey, now you know when you're taking, you know, by the way, when you can schedule your work in the spring, not just the fall, that you're gonna schedule your 20, 30 hours of work around this, well, now you know when the classes are, right? A couple colleges are starting to get there now. Cuyahoga Community College in Ohio is one of them. Rather than doing academic assessments, which is when students come in, we test them in the two subjects they are most likely to hate in high school, math and English. and tell them, guess what, we don't think you're college material either. Congratulations, you're gonna take these long courses. Maybe we actually work on a more holistic major, assuming that there's a lot of things our students don't know how to do that we need to help them with. It's not just about math and English. It's non-cognitive stuff, you know, social capital, hope, motivation, confidence, a lot of things that are past academic development. And kind of the long remediation models to correct models, I mean, it's counterintuitive, but we have learned a lot about what happens when you assume students can do something and rather assume they can't. Giving them the right support for it. Rather than only focusing on algebra and English comp, we know there are critical program courses in every discipline. We know at Allied Health it tends to be A and P, or microbiology. That's just as critical of a gatekeeper course as math is for an Allied Health student. Econ, I think it's microeconomics, it always gets people. There's one course in each kind of program that's really hard. Why not focus on those courses and helping more students get through them? And then, if we're gonna do dual credit and dual enrollment, rather than doing a la carte, we actually start program pathways beginning in high school. I wanna make one observation about pathways, is that, as Gretchen Schmidt says, who will be at a couple of the other colleges, these are pathways, not prisons. Once you pick a pathway, it's not like you can ever get, but nope, you're done, sorry, you picked phlebotomy, we're sorry you don't like blood. Either you do phlebotomy or you're out of here, right? That's not how, so these are default pathways that will get customized for every student. And also, by the way, if we tell a student, we think that the right humanities course for you this semester is art history. And the student says, I hate art, I love music, I want to take music theory. If it's the same distribution requirement, why, we would never say no to that. But we're trying to give students a default pathway. Now, if we do the scheduling right, the schedule might not work for that switch, because we set up the schedule with the default pathway. But we're gonna allow those types of substitutions. We're gonna allow students, and if someone wants to change, by the way, they can change pathways. If we do this right, and we get more people to change earlier, so if we do the meta major thing, right, whatever we call them, and someone decides in their first semester, you know what, turns out I hate biology. I wanna do business. It's far better to have that happen in semester one than it is semester five, right? In semester one, pretty much everything you took in that biology kind of like first semester is gonna translate over, because you probably took one bio course, one math course, and two GE courses. Well, those will come over, and then we'll customize your path to figure out what you need to do in business. Questions on these? Observations? Concerns? Worries? Some examples, this is something that Jackson College does in Michigan to help people get into the career pathway, so they're doing these career exploration earlier. This is to help them make decisions on the various, they actually call their meta majors pathways. They have a student planner that they've used, they've customized their own technology tool for this. At Valencia, the new student experience is really clear as you come into the college, how do you move through the various stages, getting into degree programs. They have this life path thing they do under everything in Valencia. Skip some of this stuff. This is Pearson, Washington, with some career pathways where it shows you paths from high school to Clover Park out of the high school district into Pierce College in Washington. Just a couple of examples there. Keep going, yeah, there you go. Yeah, so this, and theoretically, so your job, the job of advisors when that happens has always been to figure out what counts and what do you need to customize to finish. It's not gonna change too much, except for what you're gonna have is a clearer, here's what we think the requirements are, here's what you did. So I think it should make that kind of transcript review process a little easier, but you're still gonna do that. Davis likes to say from CCRC that there's three levels of this. There's kind of the meta major, here's the general area, common first semester, that's as you pick a program. Then we have a default pathway, say for biology. But every student's pathway is gonna end up being customized slightly because of things like they took two courses in high school. They took AP Bio, right? They were at South Florida, they took four courses. We have to figure out, are we gonna accept any of those four courses? So, I think the default story is, again, we're trying to get the default for 75% of the students. There's always gonna be 25 who have some combination of reasons they can only take classes after 2 p.m. Right? Well, in that scenario, like, we're gonna have to figure out what they can do. I think the trick is we're gonna take some ownership over that and not just let it be random chance. But yeah, when students are transferring in units, there's still going to be a process we need to figure out where they are and probably to customize. All right, so you know, the example I give on this is I was an undergrad at Stanford. This is in like 89 when I kind of decided, you know, pre-med not really good for me, probably not good for patients. I'm going to change out of human biology to psychology. And so I went into the advisor's office, and I remember this very clearly. I was a really good student in high school, I like 4.0. I had a really good SAT scores. I was 100% Pell. And the only thing I was thinking, I was a really good student. I was probably a 3.2 or something at Stanford. I knew you had a problem academically. But this like event right here was like my life, right? It was the quarters, spring quarter of my sophomore year. So I'm 6 quarters in, thinking, I can't afford this to take longer. Like, I can barely afford to be here in the first place. And I remember this before computers. So she was doing like, you know, haiku and stuff to figure out what the hell I needed to do. And it was literally, like, I was sitting there, she was like doing stuff over there, papers were flying up. And I just remember that was like 12 minutes where I sat there, I was petrified. And I was thinking, I thought later in life, like, I was a really good student. I was still that petrified. This experience is not about academics. It's about how this is all fitting in your life. And when she came back, she's like, okay, you want to get out of here on time? Here's what you take exactly to finish in your last 6 quarters to get out of here on time. And then as I was walking out, she's like, wait a minute, I didn't see that you had 15 units of AP from whatever. I had like 15 units of AP coming out of high school. She's like, let me see something here. Give me that back. And she worked on it again. She's like, I think you can get out a quarter early if you take 19 units in these 2 quarters and 7. And like, so, and she said, you want to do it? Well, yeah, that's $6,000. Now it's probably $25,000. But so there is going to be that level of customization, both by financial situations, life situations, transferring a unit. We're not getting rid of that. What we're trying to actually do is to create more time so that we can do those type of things where we have these clear pathways for, you know, 2/3 or 3/4 of the students. So it's a really good observation and really important that we are still going to be doing that. It should be easier when we know it's very clear where they're going to go on their pathways too. So. All right, let's kind of get to the next one here. So here's the advisor. We got a bunch of advisors in the room. And the info dump and orientation. Like, I love when we put in mandatory. I want to be really clear. I like mandatory orientation as an idea. One of the things I do, I work on the Aspen Prize and like travel to all the finalist colleges and visit them. And I do a lot of these like 1 and 2 day site visits where we ask a lot of questions about what the colleges are doing. I hear colleges say, hey, we've got mandatory orientation. And then I, being who I am, say, cool, what do you expect your graduation rate to go up when you put in mandatory orientation? How much? No one's going to say that they actually expected the graduation rate to go up much more than, I didn't even argue, like a tenth of a point by putting in mandatory orientation. Doesn't mean mandatory orientation is bad. It means it's one step in a very long process, and it's at the start. And we tend to do a mandatory orientation and say, all right, here's everything you're going to need to know in the next 2 to 5 years, and just remember it when it happens, which we know from research, by the way, doesn't work. Not just doesn't work for students, it doesn't work for us. My mental image for this is always, I don't know, how many of you have seen that show, Do You Think You Can Survive, on the Weather Channel? This is a show where, like, I'm a dork, I know. They give you a scenario, like, and they say, you're trapped in a car in a culvert where there's flash flooding. And I'm always thinking to myself, well, how did that happen? But let's just assume that we are for a second. So you're in a car in a culvert, it says, do you A, stay in the car? B, stand on the roof of the car and yell for help. Or C, you know, there's 3 options. And as I'm watching this, I'm always thinking to myself, and then they tell you that, you know, if you stay in the car, you're going to die. If you stand on the roof, you get, whatever the 3rd option was with the right answer, I don't know what it was. Or no, actually you are, whatever. This is the point, right? I've seen this like 10 times, and I don't know what the answer is. So it's cool that I know what the 3 options are now, and you tell me you definitely should stay in the car. 18 months from now, when I'm in a culvert, which I hope doesn't happen, in the car with flash flooding, now is when I need the information. I need a pop-up screen to say, hey, jackass, stay in the car. Don't try swimming, you're dead. Don't get out. So this is the point I think about with mandatory orientation. Like, we tell students, here's everything that could go wrong. Here's what you do if it does, right? And rather than actually providing them just-in-time support. The idea here is, you know, and the reason we do this is because we actually had them, right? We're very excited that we actually have them for half an hour to 3 hours. So we try to solve everything. Rather than realizing that students are going to run into problems at a certain time in their pathway, we need that support to be there when they do. Scheduling, we've already talked about this, the scheduling available courses to suit the college schedule, which I think is a solipsism type of my philosophy. Scheduling courses on the student's path to fit their schedule. Full-time, part-time, this is a big Davis Jenkins thing, that there's this whole notion of full-time versus part-time is really a kind of a red herring. And actually what we should be focusing on is whether students are on their path or off, because students vary from full-time to part-time. One thing we do know about this, and I have a huge rant, I don't have time to do on this, I'm a part-time student. We're very fond of saying, this all sounds great for full-time students, but we have so many part-time students, we can't do this. Well, two things. One, you're assuming they wouldn't go full-time if you had a different set of conditions, right? Like they know why they're at the college, they know what their value proposition is. You've told them, hey, guess what, if you do this, here's your payoff, if you dedicate the time to this. We also give them student financial stability to help them actually get the support they need. We work on things like childcare, transportation, nutrition, tie-in with public benefits, all the things that our low-income students need help with. And the other side of that is that we shouldn't be okay with the fact that so many students are part-time. Because if you don't like your numbers for completion rates for full-time students, take a look at it for part-time students. Where if you see students who never take more than 9 units in a semester and actually calculate not their 3-year completion rate, but their 10-year completion rate, you'll find it's somewhere around 1 in 7 actually complete. So we've made this assumption it's okay, it just takes longer. Students have complicated lives. Well, the data does not bear that out at all. Yeah, they got complicated lives, but now they never finish. Right, for a wide variety of reasons. So as you saw earlier, we can have program plans for part-time, but it has to be part-time. This notion of full-time, part-time, off-plan, on-plan is kind of an important one. Here's a big one. This is a classic, all right, mainly advisors in the room, a couple of faculty. All right, advisors, you advise, and teacher, faculty, you guys teach. When in fact, we are arguing pretty strongly that advisors teach and faculty advise. Whether it's formal or not, like, you could have the best student services model in the country where you saw a student for, say, 4 hours in a semester. You saw them twice. Like, that would be awesome, right? You never see a student for 4 hours. But, you know, TRIO programs, sometimes the OPS programs in California. But let's say you saw someone for 4 hours in student services, and that student's full-time. They're in a classroom 200-plus hours. So whatever you're doing in those 4 hours has to be supported by what's happening in the 200 hours in the classroom. Vice versa, the faculty not only advise in the classroom formally and interim, but advisors teach, right? We're helping students figure out what their goals are, where they're trying to go. There's classroom instruction, there's non-classroom instruction. We gotta stop treating these as if they're not like two different worlds. It's all part of the holistic way we're serving our students. I don't have a lot of time to go into this. These are just some decisions along the path. Some quick things on advising. I was here at the advising workshop on Friday. I went home and came back because, you know, that's how I do things. Some big ideas of advising. I'm going to get to, I have a slide up here because of time. These are all good slides. That one scares the hell out of me, by the way. Key redesign features of advising. Personal contacts early on, case management, connection with faculty and others in their field of interest, and responsibility for guiding students into and through program paths shared by all faculty and staff, regardless of whether they have formal roles in advising. We thought early on in this guided pathways movement that the big issues were going to be program mapping, right? Can we get faculty, especially gen ed faculty like me, I'm talking about myself, to arrange kind of classically gen ed things into programs? We found out pretty early on that advising was just as big of a hurdle. And it was good people, by the way, same good people on all sides. But the assumption that it's okay to explore, it's okay to wander, students should be allowed to make their own choices. By the way, all of which is still true, they're gonna make their own choices. But this notion of this self-guided model is really ingrained in advising in many places. I've had advisors tell me, I'm never gonna tell a student what to do, that's their job. Okay, well, advisors suggest you should be at least helping them, but okay, you know, it's kind of in the title. But, I mean, so there's a mindset with advising here that the case management is a mindset, right? We've had a drop-in model historically. We don't own students. So we've resisted case management, maybe not philosophically, but from a resources standpoint. How do we serve that many students if it's a case management model? A lot of advisors here. What do you guys think about advising in this potential new world order? What worries you or what excites you about that as you think about advising more around pathways?
I don't have any worries. Just like a lot of things, you know, you want to see what's ahead, so.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I think what should happen is that you're working really closely with faculty, right, to figure these things out. Sometimes we talk about the program mapping teams, and we strongly think there should be student services involved in program mapping teams, because I can design a really cool, by the way, pathway to an AA in social psychology, and it's not until I have a transfer person with me where they go, yeah, that's cool, but guess what? Seven of those courses you just put in there don't transfer to ASU. So I've created a path to nowhere, right? So we gotta make sure we're working together on these things. And there are things that advisors would know about what course going in the right order, maybe that a faculty member would know, right? So we need to work together on these things. That's one of the big barriers we're trying to break down. So yeah.
Well, I just wanted to mention on the topic of advising, I did some research back in 2008, 2009, and it's been corroborated by this college's own community college surveys of student engagement.
Yep.
And our Buffalo Noel Lovett surveys that the main issue students have with advising is that they go asking questions and their advisors won't give them the answers. They just flip and say, well, what do you want to do?
Right.
What do you want to be? So that there's that conundrum where the students are actually going to the advisor wanting to get direction. And the advisors are saying, well, you need to provide your own direction.
Yeah, and we're trying to work on things like self-efficacy and all of these things and self-direction. But I think there may be a different way to do that than turning this really confusing system back around to the students. And then that's for students who come, right? The other things you hear from students, by the way, there's a huge advisor thing Sessie just released, is about to release, I think they did last week, yeah. You know, when you talk to students, students are really clear about a couple of things with advisors. They can be really helpful, but in a model that's not case management, one of the biggest problems they have is they ask the advisor they see today, the same version of the question they said last time, and they get a different answer, right? Or they're annoyed because the advisor today doesn't know what they talked about with the advisor before. And that's kind of, there's two things. There's a technology piece to that. But that's also a case management thing, right? If you actually own the student, you know what you talked about before, you can bring it back up from the notes. There's this assumption that students somehow like wandering, right? Yeah, out of 100 students, there's probably 3 to 5 who love wandering. The other 95, when you do focus groups, are very clear. Tell me what I need to take to get to where I want to go and help me figure out where that is, please. Like, there's studies from dozens of states that all show the exact same thing here, that students want direction, they want to be guided. Version in California called Student Support Redefined, 1,000 community college students from 20 colleges, focus groups, interviews, the top two factors of what they wanted out of student services were to be directed and focused, right? Top two. So, I mean, and I think a lot of, you know, one thing that's going on under there is that a lot of us were wanderers. Like, we found higher education through wandering, so we're very protective of the wandering path that led us to where we are. This is true of faculty and student services, by the way. And the problem is the model doesn't work that way for most people, right? We are the ones who kind of succeeded in the model. And the data tells us that 6 out of 10, some places 7 out of 10, aren't getting through the wandering model. So I think you bring these things together and it creates this nexus of reasons this is so important. And we don't have a lot of faculty here, so this learning one, I gotta tell you, this Ensure Students Are Learning is our weakest section in the Guidance Pathways model, because it's hard, it has been hard to get at kind of GE outcomes as well as program outcomes. The liberal arts learning outcomes, things like critical thinking, computation, communication. We have a hard time measuring those things in higher education. We firmly believe we need to emphasize those things, but we do not have a lot of great stories on this. It's one of the reasons I like what some of the early adopters of Maricopa have done by trying to tie in a discussion of liberal arts outcomes with the program mapping, but it's an ongoing thing. This is all stuff you don't need. Yeah, I'm gonna skip this stuff. This is for a longer presentation. Couple minutes left for questions still. I mean, we've been doing it all along, but if you want to explore a bunch of questions that I've already written about, because I've been doing this for a long time, we actually, I put together two papers called Guided Pathways Demystified that worked through the top 10 questions I had heard in the first version, like it was 3 years ago. And then 10 new ones I heard in the second version. So I'm just gonna show them to you really quickly because there's about a page on each of these. Just exploring it, not saying I have the answer, but just exploring the question. People ask things like, I'm joking in here because I wrote the first one to you that out for free, so I decided to write another one. I made so much money on the first one. Really got to work on my model. There's a Mel Brooks reference in here too. Dating me. Questions like, this is one of the older ones we don't get as much from here. Although I just heard a version of this in California recently. Isn't college a meritocracy where the strong and smart are supposed to succeed and the weak and underprepared are supposed to be weeded out? There's obviously some equity implications to this question. Who are we weeding out and what do we think students can do? I'm not going to go into these. Isn't free choice the cornerstone of American higher education? Won't we sacrifice quality when we move to guided pathways? Won't we lose the heart of a liberal arts education when we make students' journeys more structured? Won't faculty lose control over what's taught in their discipline? Won't we lose enrollment if we decrease swirl with increased structure by making things mandatory? This is like the DMV argument. Because the DMV and the real world are confusing, we should be that confusing to prepare people. Actually, I heard someone use the DMV argument on this, by the way. That we're creating people who can't navigate the real world. As if, by the way, having 6 of 10 of them fail out of here is somehow helping them navigate the real world. Don't students benefit by when they find themselves, by what looks like wandering to an observer? Career decisions at age 18, don't we change careers 4 to 7 times? So there's a little bit on each of these questions. On my website, there's a discussion PowerPoint that has discussion questions on each of these 10. I still need to do it for the second 10 questions. You can see these questions are a little more theoretical, these first 10. The next 10, because it was 2 years later, are a little more practical. Isn't guided pathways just the next education path? I love this question, by the way, because the people who ask this said, I've been here 25 years, you guys have been telling me something new every 2 years. And by the way, they were right every other time. Every other educational path, they were right to just wait out. And we have to make this, I love this one, because it lets you talk about how you have to make this difference. The guided pathway is a movement, it's not an initiative. That's kind of cool. How do we further emphasize equity and inclusion? How about building effective guided pathways for part-time students? What about when students are below transfer level math language? What happens if they change their mind? You can see these are more operational questions we get now. What about when students fall off their pathway? Hey, what about teaching and learning? How does this shift under guided pathways? Doesn't faculty workload go up under a guided pathways model? Aren't we already overworked enough? This is a great question, by the way. How do we best use technology and how do we get all the work necessary and plan and execute this by a certain date? So these are just, by the way, to leaders I always say, if you haven't heard these questions, it means that no one believes you're doing anything yet, gonna do anything. Because you'll hear some version of nearly all of these questions the second people start believing this is real. Because some of those numbers, like back to number 10, those are a lot of people just thinking, I'll just wait this out. It'll pass this right by like everything else did. It's when they start believing this is real where you start getting versions of these 20 questions thrown out to you. 2 or 3 minutes left, any final questions for you guys? So, by the way, the papers on these are this is a long PowerPoint. I walked through some slides. Let me get you to the end here so you can download these if you want to.
It's so free, you can actually just Google it too.
It comes up pretty quick. But my website here has them under publications. You'll see both of those. There's kind of some other cool stuff on there around as well. Other questions, observations? Anyone really worried about something right now? That I'll go longer than the next 2 minutes. That's always an immediate worry. What do you think your peers are worried about when they enter guided pathways? Other people on campus?
I would say advisors are worried about having more advice and help.
Yeah. Totally fair. I mean, you can't do case management advising with a 1700:1 ratio. You just can't. Like, there's no way to do that. I mean, I don't have a PhD in logistics, but you can't divide 1700 into a semester of just doing, maybe if you did it 40 hours a week, which it would be, you'd all leave if that wasn't the case. But yeah, so that has to be a piece of this. And you may not have required advising every semester. It may be check-in. Like, this is all to be decided still. It has to be, you guys. And as we said earlier, this work is in front of you, figuring out what to do, not behind you, so.
I'm going to go along with that. It's, turnover is so high with advisors or staff. So if you want to get in here, have that one advisor student, a certain one, but it changes all the time.
Yeah, and that is, again, one of the things we think is a good idea, is the tailoring of advisors to different programs. But to do that, you got to have some people sticking with it. Probably changes hiring a little if you're looking for people with some specialties versus generalists. This whole specialist generalist thing advising is tricky, right? I think there's some huge benefits to having someone be more knowledgeable about a certain area, But there's a flip side to that, which is that sometimes advisors might advise them on a variety of things. So those are all trade-offs that have to be explored. Yeah. Yes?
Just going back to the drawing board, the schedule, like how, you know, that's something we struggle with all the time. And we work really hard. So program-specific courses with gen ed courses to make sure that they're, you know, we try and meet with a lot of our gen ed faculty to make sure that, oh, you move the math during the only time that we were offering that, you know, just.
There is no easy answer to this other than you have to iteratively look at it. So here's the good news. When everyone's on a path, now this starts getting easier, right? Because now you know that when you start looking at a path that, hey, I kind of need this gen ed like distribution requirement 7. I need to slot this in here. Guess what? We don't have anything on the schedule yet. I'm going to tell you, the scheduling piece of this is really thorny. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't start with scheduling. Like, you have to get a lot of the pathway stuff done first.
Right.
And in the end, like, it actually will be easier to schedule once you get there, and once you figure out where students are going to vote with their feet into these pathways, you'll know how to schedule. Because right now, it's all about, will this course fill versus what's program are students going to be in. This is a huge shift in how we do scheduling. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you would say something first, too.
Well, I was just going to say, when you said, when you first were talking, I got the feeling of all the hard work that you all, faculty are already doing to create the schedules. So you said it's going to be easier, but people are willing to do that work. Now they just have more purpose in
them. Chris,
I think that's so when you gather with all your colleagues from all the other disciplines in your division, and make sure you don't conflict or make sure you're a great blend of offerings or evening classes as well, you're still going to do that hard work.
Yeah, what was your name?
Jennifer.
Jennifer, and the other thing I would say is this, we turn the tape off this part, but if you go down this path eventually, no one can say I'm not playing. And they can right now, because we're scheduling in these one-off ways that allow someone to say, I'm sorry, I'm teaching it this time. When you go to this mindset of what do students need to take to get to where they want to go, you're forcing everyone into the conversation, and that can be painful. Sometimes you're happier when people aren't in the conversation. But if you're going to solve these problems, like, we're going to have to wrestle with some things. Like, who owns classrooms? I mean, I know, oh man, the politics of classrooms, right? No, that's my classroom. Well, okay, that's interesting, but, you know, so this is why this takes time. Like, you can't solve this problem in 6 months. And you're not going to get the, here's the other really important thing I want to leave you with. There is no right answer the first time you do. There's never the right answer. There's version 1.0, version 2.0, version 3.0. The places that have hit home runs on this, long-term change. You don't get it right. So we are suggesting to leadership that the earliest you think of fully implementing guided pathways is fall 20, and we can make an argument for fall 21, that it actually takes 3 full years to get this. Now, you're gonna do some things along the way that are gonna help students. You guys already decided this? Did I not hear a memo? Chris, is there a memo behind this somewhere?
No, there's some or from the top, it's going to happen quicker in 3 years.
Yeah, so I think that our advice is going to be that, yeah, I know what you're talking about. I think that there are things you can probably roll out in fall 19, but I think fall 18, you're not rolling anything out in fall 18, it's going to be significant. Some of these maps, maybe, I just think there's a danger to doing this piecemeal, that kind of blocks progress in some areas, accelerates it in others. This is something we're going to rise up the flagpole about. I think they need a bold statement of, okay, it's fall 20, and here's what will happen in fall 19. So we know how to stage the work backwards from that, because I think you guys need to have that backward design from the work.
Yeah.
But it takes time. It takes time. And just there's no way we want to minimize how complicated some of those things are. I think I'm getting the visual cues that we need to get moving to the next place. So you're like, faculty are waiting, we have to go. Thank you guys so much for your time. If you have questions, feel free to email me. We're here for you all this time. Thank you guys so much.